everyone to the ANA eLearning Academy. Today we have George who will be presenting on the how do you pronounce it?
Charonian. Charonian.
Okay. I looked it up beforehand and it said three or four different things. The Charonian coin, the toll to the afterworld. If you have any questions during this presentation, you will be muted. So please put them in the Q&A or the chat and I will read them to George at the end. But go ahead and get started. We're excited to hear from you.
Thank you very much, Logal. Let me share the screen. So hello, everybody. I'm happy to be with you today. And we will discuss the issue of Charonian coin, as I call it, the toll to the afterworld. So this is a presentation that is mixing up coins and history and many interesting archaeological findings. Although I'm not an archaeologist, I'm an engineer. I'm involved with collecting coins from 10 years old. That time I was living in Greece. In Greece, it was and it is still illegal to collect ancient coins. So at that time, my only choice was to collect modern coins. When I came to America, I discovered that I had the option to explore the collecting ancient also coins. So that's what I'm doing for a few years now, and I enjoy. So today I will discuss you about the tradition of coinage related to death and how in the ancient world, in Europe actually, they were handling this issue and how what traditions and what history is behind that. Before I will go to the coins issues, I would like to give you some background because we should understand also a little bit about the terminology. So when we say Charonian coin, where this name comes from? The name of the Charonian coin comes from Charon. Charon was the boatman of the underworld. And Charon used to row the souls, to transfer the souls of dead people across a river to their internal destination. The river was called Acheron, and in Latin language it is known as Styx. And if the dead could not pay the fare, that because there was a fare for that one coin, and we will explain about that later, they were doomed to wander in the riverbank. So this was a wide tradition, and the Charonian coin is exactly that coin that the dead people had to pay, the souls had to pay to Charon in order to transfer them to the underworld. Now, it is interesting to understand how people were understanding underworld in ancient Greece. So they were calling it the realm of Hades. We will explain later about Hades. And in the underworld in ancient Greece had two levels. One level was called Elysium, or Elysian fields, or Elysian plains. And is what how we consider that in the modern time as the paradise. It was the place which heroes and gods and good people were sent. And it was the place of the blessed dead. And only you could enter that area if you had a righteous life. You were a good person during your life. Now for the rest of the people that they were not good guys, there was the realm of Hades. And from the realm of Hades, there was a second part, the opposite of Elysium, Tartarus. So Tartarus was the deep abyss. It was the lower of the two levels and of the two parts of the underworld. And it was a dungeon of torment and sadness. It was the place that the souls were judged after death and they were getting the divine punishment they were deserving. So it is consistent to what we consider now as hell. So the logic of the paradise and the hell, as you see, it really was there in ancient time and was the acceptable culture, I could say. I also mentioned Hades. I said the whole underworld was the kingdom of Hades. And who was Hades? Let's see a little bit the genealogy according to the Greek ancient Greek cosmogony and mythology. So according to the that story going in mythology back eons ago, everything started from Aether. Aether was the upper and the divine sky. And from Aether was born Uranus and Gaia, which was the heaven and the earth. And then from heaven and the earth, their kids were the Titans. And among them, it was Cronus, who was the golden age of humanity, and Rhea, that was considered the mother of gods. From Cronus and Rhea, they had three kids, among others, that the main kids were Hades, Zeus, and Poseidon. Hades, that I already mentioned, was the king of Underworld. So he received the kingdom of Underworld to control. Zeus, Theas, received the kingdom of sky. And Poseidon received the kingdom of sea and the solid earth. So those Hades, Zeus, and Poseidon, the ancient gods of Greece, they were actually brothers, and they shared controlled underworld and upper world. So Hades, in a Latin language, it is Pluto, known as Pluto, was the god of the underworld and boss of Charon. So Charon, who was transferring the souls to the underworld of the dead people, was working for Hades. So Hades appears on a wide range of coins, mainly 2nd and 10th century provincial bronzes. And I give you some example here. And actually, the way we see Hades is by abducting his bride Persephone. So Persephone was the story of Persephone was very, very popular. You can see here two coins at the bottom. When you see, just a note, when you see on the coin the orange dot, it comes from my collection. When there's no dot, it comes from bibliography. So you see on the top, for example, how Hades is abducting Persephone to become his queen on Underworld. This is a beautiful mosaic from Amphipolis in northern Greece. It's called the Casta Tomb. And it was excavated recently, 7 years ago. So you see that mosaic. And this picture of Hades stealing Persephone, you can see it on the coins here and here. Very, very popular myth in ancient time. So Charon coin, although we have many coins that were found in tombs and they are Charon coins, by itself, we don't have a coin with Charon image. So it is mentioned everywhere, but without any image of such a coin. So Charon coin is mentioned for first time in literature around 400 BC, 5th century BC. And one very common passage is coming from Aristophanes, who wrote the play Frogs for the theater. It was a comedy for the ancient theater. And I have here, I will go through a little bit the small dialogue where we see this reference to Charon. And then it was a story about Dionysus and Hercules, that the Hercules wants to visit the underworld. And Dionysus say, okay, I will go the way you went. So he asking Hercules to explain how to do it. Hercules, sorry, was already being there and Dionysus was to go there. And say, that's the longest way. It's a huge trip to go to the underworld. All right, then look, first you will come to a huge lake, an abyss, and it is bottomless. And then Dionysus asks, so how do I get to the other side of that lake? Hercules replies, on a tiny boat by a very old sailor. He is Charon. He will take the 2 obol fare, same as the fare to the theater. So this is the first historical reference to the Charon coin that it is saved up to now in the literature. And then Dionysus say, well, we'll look at that, the power of the 2 obols. Hey, everywhere you go, 2 obols, please, 2 obols, please. So because that time in ancient Athens, 2 obols was the minimal payment you could pay, the coin of 2 obols. And then Hercules says, Theseus took them down with him when he went down to bring Persephone up. After you cross the lake, you will see millions of snakes and beasts. and things that are too horrible to contemplate. And Saint Dionysius should say, oh, come on, brother, don't frighten me. I can do it anyway. So that's the first reference. And this specific play was not only played in ancient theater, but it is also played even today in modern theater. It is one of the most popular comedies of ancient Greek plays. You can see here pictures from this Aristophanes play at the Broadway, from the Broadway at the Lincoln Center at the New York. Okay. Now, the Charonian obol that there was the first mention before, as I mentioned you in the literature, was an obol was originally a small silver coin valued at 1/6 of a drachma. And after the Greek-speaking cities of the East Mediterranean were absorbed in the Roman Empire, obol was often used to describe a low-value bronze coin. In reality, there was devaluation of the coin due to the time. So it started from small silver coin and it became small, low-value bronze coin. And on the Attic weight, which is the standard weight of classical Greece, a noble weighted 0.72 grams. In the older system of standard of Aegina, the island close to Athens, it was 1.05 grams. So you see from 1.05 grams, we dropped to 0.72. Inflation again. Now, what obol means? The word obol means originally in Greek language roasting spit. And the reason is that during that time, before even have the traditional coins, the people at that time in that area of the world, they're using bundles of iron roasting spits as primitive coinage. You can see on the picture here on the right, top right, this is the graph, how they were holding them. And if you compare with the human hand, you can see their size. And this is an actual batch of such coins, the primitive obols, that they are now saved and you can visit and observe them at the Numismatic Museum of Athens in Greece. In the pictures below, I am presenting you some obols, silver obols from my collection that they were issued in many different regions of the ancient world and with many different nice symbols on them, depending, of course, the region they were coming from. Now, a very popular Charonian coin that was not a noble. It was called Danaki or Lamella. And Danaki comes from the Greek word Danos, which means Thanatos. So if you watched the Avengers, the movie, you notice that the bad guy is called Thanos. Thanos is this one. Okay, so it's death. So when they developed the Avengers, the Thanos was not a name by coincidence, but it has an indirect meaning to death. So Danaki or Lamella were these coins, small coins, which were not actual coins that you could use in your everyday life, that were used just for the dead as Charonian coins. And these pseudo coins were made of gold that was impressed over various designs. And it was called uniface coin because it did not have two different designs of both sides. There was only one. That's why you can see, the picture of such coins. And then you see just their negative on the back. So the one is Helios as Apollo. The other one depicts a honeybee. So they were pressing a foil, a thin point of gold. It was approximately half to a quarter of a gram of gold. It had a diameter 6 to 12 millimeters, and it was found in tombs that they were dated 5th to 1st century BC. An example was also found in Athenian Agora in Athens, that in that case, the photo was an owl, the Athenian owl. So that coin, that pseudo coin, not real coin, was used just as Charonian coin, just for the death. Another very interesting passage from the ancient literature about Charonian Charon and transferring the death from to the other side and the small payment comes from the play Dead by Lucian of Samosata. Lucian of Samosata was wrote those dialogues. And this is a dialogue between Charon and Menippus. Menippus from Gadara was a satirist. So that's also a comedy here. And what we see is that Menippus dies. He goes to Charon and he has to use his boat to be transferred to the underworld, but he has no money to pay. So the whole comedy comes exactly from this dialogue when Charon says, "You're fair, you rascal." And Menippus says, "Boil away, Charon, if it gives you any pleasure." Charon says, "I brought you a cross. Give me my fare." And Menippus says the famous, "You can't get blood from a stone," which is used even now in many different versions, in many different languages. And Charon says, "And who is so poor that he has not get an obol?" Again, the obol, one obol. Menippus says, I am for one, I don't know who else. And Charon says, "Pay or Pluto, I will strangle you." Pluto is Hades, his boss. And Menippus replies, "And I will crack your skull with this stick." Charon becomes angry and says, "So you are to come all that way for nothing?" And Menippus says, and he refers to Hermes. Hermes was the god who was transferring the souls to the lake before Charon will take them to the underworld. God Hermes. And Menippus says, "Let Hermes pay for me. He put me on board." And Hermes, the god who is there, says, "I dare say, a fine time I shall have of it if I'm to pay for the sage." Charon replies, "I'm not going to let you off." Menippus says, "You can haul up your ship and wait for all I care. I have not got any money. I can't pay you, can I?" And then that's the whole story goes on and becomes funny. And Menippus in mythology remains the first person that was able to cross the Acheron lake and without paying the Charonian coin. So the story of Charonian coin is also found in modern films. This is a picture of the Troy, a film that it was released from Hollywood 2004. In that movie, this is the point where King Priam of Troy, that was played by Peter O'Toole, he's visiting the tent of the Greek hero Achilles, that he was played by Brad Pitt, and he's begging for the mutilated corpse of his son Hector so that he may receive a proper funeral. And then King Priam is pleading Achilles by saying, "Let me place two coins on his eyes for the boatman." So again, the story of Charonian coin is here. And this is a much modern Hollywood movie, very recent, The Fair, that I am suggesting, if you didn't see that, you can see it, it is worth it. That also it's a mystery thriller film, The Fair. And this fair exactly is the Charonian coin, a modern version of Persephone and Charon myth. So in a point of the movie, it says, "This is for your ride." And he is giving him the Charonian coin. So every time in history, this myth is used in ancient theaters, in comedies, but also in modern movies. Now, if we go a little bit on the history of the coins that they are used for death people, we'll start also with the pre-coins that they were dolphin-shaped coins and they found in hands of skeletons in the ancient Olvia. Ancient Olvia is in Ukraine, where is modern Ukraine now? And it is the modern city of Odessa. The ancient city of Odessa is not at this point exactly, it was close by. So Olvia, in the period even from 7th and 6th century BC, in tombs, we found but archaeologists found this nice small bronze dolphins that they were used as Charonian coins. So the history goes far away. We don't know if it was directly related with the history as we know it as Charonian coin, but it was all this, many of those dolphins were found in the hands of the skeletons. So the logic is the same. So from this point of my presentation, I will present you some archaeological findings of Charonian coins, so you will see through the history of time how they were used. The next point we are jumping, the next area we are jumping, is the necropolis. Necropolis is the cemetery of the ancient Abdera. The ancient Abdera was a city on the modern area of Greece, which is called Thrace. What we see here, we see from excavations of from 2006 on the necropolis of Abdera findings, and you can see here on the left, exactly in the cycle where I put my arrow, the Charonian coins. Actually, there were found 10 tombs with Charonian coins. 78 tombs were excavated in total, and in 10 tombs, they found Charonian coins. Now, don't forget that many of the ancient tombs were already visited before by people that were looking for treasures and so on. So we are not sure that this means that only 10 out of 78 tombs had the coin, because they are probably the other tombs were looted. So it is very difficult to have a statistical example and statistical calculation of how many tombs they had Charonian coin. But this is how it looked, and this is the specific coin that it was found on that specific tomb. If we move a little bit eastern, this again in what is modern Greece, and this is Pella. Pella was the center of a Macedonian kingdom. We're talking about the period 350 to 300 BC. In excavations that were done in 2000, they found also Charonian coins in the mouths of dead people, the remains. And examples of those coins you can see here. There were bronze drachms with a King Cassander. This is the one with the horse rider, lion, and Alexander the Great, where you see the coin with the Jewish thunderbolt here on the bottom. So if we go also in that area in the Vergi, the village of Vergi on the region of Ceres, in also again, this is Macedonia in modern Greece. On the period, we found Charonian coins that they were on tombs from 2nd to 6th century BC. They found coins on 10 tombs, mainly from the Hellenistic period cemetery. You can see how the tomb was and some of the findings. And exactly on the right, you will see the some of the Charonian coins that were found in the tombs. In the same region, but in the Amphipoli Casta tomb, the one I showed you, the nice depicturing with Persephone. Look here on the bottom where I have my cursor. That one I did show you earlier. That tomb was started excavated on 2015. It is one of the royal so-called the tombs. This period had a cemetery that was ranging from 430 BC to 800 AC. So it was used for more than 1200 years in history as a cemetery. This specific tomb is the Casta tomb. This is, you can see the beautiful findings, and you can see the tomb inside this construction, this beautiful construction. The Casta tomb was assumed, and it is assumed now by the archaeologists, that it is the tomb of Hephaestion, the closest friend and general of Alexander the Great. And you can see in the wall, they found the monogram of Hephaestion. It was not found only in one or two locations. So this is the evidence that is supporting the theory that it was indeed the tomb of Hephaestion. And also the whole structure of the tomb and the luxurious construction, it was compatible to somebody who was a very important person. This is how the central area of the tomb looked like on the lower right end. And then our findings from the excavation, this was a looted tomb. So what was found was very small, very few things from what it would be expected to be there initially. Now going southern in Greece, we will jump on the excavations of ancient Kranon. Very, very new excavation. only 3 years ago. They found tombs like this. That was the type of the tomb that it was found with Charonian coin. And you can see on the bottom to the right, some of these Charonian coins that were found. You can see also one similar coin from my collection on top. So that was the coin used on that region in Thessalia. So it is Thessalia of central Greece. Now, also going a little bit southern, we go to Evrytania, very, very also recent excavation, 3 years ago. Tombs were found of the period of 2nd and to 4th century AC. Many Charonian coins on skull, inside the skulls. And you can see here with the yellow arrow, one of the Charonian coins. It is very difficult to distinguish, but this is where archaeologists identified the Charonian coin from that tombs. Going even south on Peloponnese, we find the Charonian coins in the excavation of Platiana in the region of Ilia. It's where Olympia, close to Olympia, is located. 2006, and we're talking about a cemetery of 350 to 300 BC. Two Charonian coins were found on two parallel tombs. So you see the excavation. So you see that it didn't have to be a rich king tomb. Even in the everyday type of tombs, the Charonian coins were there. And then if you go even southern on the island of Crete, on the western part of Crete, the modern area of Chania, the city of Aptera, Crete, on excavation that happened 2 years ago, only 2019, they found coins that they were going back to the period of 5th to 4th century BC. And also there were coins with the monogram of Hephaestion. You see again the same monogram that it was found on northern Greece on his tomb. And the reason is because that time the commerce was very common all over the cities, states of ancient Greece. So they were using coins from all over the region. So although we are in Crete now, on the excavations in Crete, they found coins that they were coming from northern Greece, from Macedonia. That was a common finding. Now in the eastern part of Crete, you can see a beautiful sample of a Charonian coin. It was found on the Greek-Roman necropolis, grave number 8 at St. Nikolaos, Crete, here on the right of Crete. It is a coin, a Charonian coin, located on a tomb of 37 to 38 BC. And the whole skull was found of a young athlete with a gold wreath and the coin. The coin was inside the skull. And now you can see the whole thing, the actual coin, and you can see the skull in the museum, in the archaeological museum of Agios Nikolaos in Crete. Very beautiful and unique finding because everything was found, not just the coin. Close by on the same region or the necropolis, the cemetery of Acanthus, many tombs were found with many different Charonian coins dated back to the 4th century BC. Now we're going again up northern in the region of Corinth, excavations of 2018, very recent, many Charonian coins from many different historical periods. I show you all these examples because I want to show you that this is happening everywhere in the country, and it is happening also in totally different historical periods. We see here that they found Charonian coins from 200 AC and also in tombs from 400 BC. So we see that for 600 years, people used to put Charonian coins in the tombs. So you see here the excavations, and you see here Charonian coins, and as you can see here, even gold ones. So depending on the level of the person who was dying and how rich he or she was, they could use not only simple obols, but they could use more expensive coins. So you see a silver platter of Athena, 400 BC, the dove from Sicyon, the gold, this one on the picture from 350 BC in different tomb, bronze Ptolemy and Septimus Severus. So many different periods. One of the, going back to Athens now, what I'm going to present you is that a very rare finding that is depicting for first time we have seen Charon by himself. So this is a finding from Keramikos Cemetery of Athens. That was the central cemetery of the old city of Athens. It was found in excavations of 2006. It is not a coin, but it is a marble relief. And the, I want just to remind you that the cemetery of Athens was used for close to 3,000 plus years, from 2700 BC to 700 AC. Very long history of for a cemetery. So in that exact area, they found the archaeologists a marble relief. And this unusual relief, this sculpture, depicts two elderly bearded men flanked by two women around a table with breads and sweets, probably during a funeral banquet. And we see, that's the extraordinary finding, from the left, the boat of Charon, with Charon, who is the guy who is handling the boat, the boatman, and who will take the diners across to the waters of Acheron. Probably the only, I don't know for more, depicts of Charon and his boat in an actual statue like this. Of course, that concludes my presentation, even that time is passing by, my presentation about the archaeological findings, about River Acheron and the boatman Charon and the... We didn't finish yet. We have more, okay?
Oh, okay.
Yeah, sorry. And about the coin used. The question, of course, it is, does really River Acheron exist? And if so, where is it located? Because that was where the dead went through, okay? So the according to the Greek mythology and the history, actually, the River Acheron existed. And not only existed, but it is still existing today. So in the western area of Greece, you know, here is Europe, this is the world, this is Europe, this is Greece. Here on the western area, it is the River Acheron region. This is the map. It is in both in English and Greek, so you can read. So this is the sea, this is Ionian Sea. On the opposite side from here is Italy. And here is the River Acheron. This is how it was in the ancient times. Now this lake is not there anymore because they removed the water to cultivate it. But still the river is there. And this is the Acheron River. And this is the Acherusia Lake. So this is me a few years ago, visiting the Acheron River. So, and there is a boat that can take you all the way up to Acheron River. This is the modern boat, and this is the modern boatman. Of course, this is not Charon. This is Nicholas, the boatman. But I'm sure that the ancient Acheron would look similar. So this is the way that the souls would go through the boatman. The good thing with me that it was not a round trip. It was not one way ticket what I paid, €5, to take me all the way up to the Acheron River. So the trip actually starts by the sea, where is the ending of Acheron River on the Ionian Sea. And there are nice, beautiful caves over there. And according to the locals, those are the ancient the entrance of the ancient world of the underworld. It was the gates that Persephone enters to return to her kingdom of Hades every 6 months. Because according to mythology, every 6 months, Persephone comes up and it is the spring, symbolizes the spring. She is living on the underworld, on the upper world for 6 months. And then on winter, she goes back and she stays with her husband Hades for 6 more months. That was her deal between Zeus, her mother Demeter, and Hades to after he stole Persephone. So in that area of Greece, there are these caves that they are supposed to be the gates to underworld. Here, this is how Acheron River looks today. So, and this is how is the boat. So if you take the boat, you can go upwards and enjoy the calm River Acheron. You can enjoy the unique, only on that river, elliptical shaped water lilies. You can find them only on this river. And you can see very beautiful nightingale nests on the trees. They are they shaped like this, and they are on the trees in order to avoid the snakes. And then, if you continue your trip, you are arriving at Necromandion. Necromandion was the oracle of dead. So it is the point where ancient river Acheron was meeting the lake Acherusia. So that where the Necromandion, the oracle, was built. And it was one of the three famous oracle sites of ancient Greece. The other two were in Delphi and Dodoni, where the alive people could meet and talk to the dead, to their dead relatives. So this is how the entrance to Necromandion, to the oracle, looks today. The story says that the visitors at Necromandion had to go through a 28, one month actually, it's one lunar month, preparation, a cleaning process for their body and soul before they meet their dead relatives. And this is how it looks today, the underground hall where the dead and the alive could meet. So the people who wanted to talk with their dead relatives, after 28 days of fasting, they would enter here. And probably archaeologists and historians say that behind these walls, it was the priests that they were speaking to them, like negotiating and mediating between the oracle and the people. So that's where they were getting their information. This is a part that the ancient reference where Odysseus, the son of Laertes, is going to visit the Hades to meet his mother. It is on Odyssea, Ulysses, stories of Homer. So this is here, and you can take a look at that. But this is exactly the place that he supposed that he visited, and they told him how to visit and how to go in the underworld. So this is where is Acheron River and the Necromantion today. So after all this presentation, there's still a question over there. Is that really the Charonian coin a myth or a reality? So from all the evidence we have, it is, yes, it is a reality. It is not a myth. It was found in many archaeological site. It is there is reference in literature, in theaters, in plays, and so on. Even here on my last PowerPoint, I have a picture of a Roman skull with an obol, an Antoninus Pius Dipondius. And you see it is in his mouth. So it was not only in ancient Greek time, all over the ancient Greek world, but it was also extending to Roman period and so on. So according to the graves, the findings in the graves, the oldest ones that they are bearing coins coming from 470 coins. I'm not talking about the pre-coins that they were found in Olvia. So the actual coins were found in tombs from 470 BC. And they were found on the hands or in the mouth or in the eyes of the dead people. Initially, it was on their hand. After 400 BC, it is mostly on their mouth. Okay. Also, we found the ghost coins, the fake coins, I was told you, the Danaki and Lamella, that they were also used as Charonian coins. Now, from the excavations we have, including the Athens cemetery, only 4 to 10% of the tombs in the tombs, they, depending the necropolis, of course, the cemetery, they found Charonian point. But as I told you, also more than 90 and 95% of the tombs are already looted. So this statistic is very weak. It is there. It is an actual statistic, but it is very difficult that this is actual true, because when 95% of the tombs are looted, of course, everybody is going to steal the coins. They are not going to leave them over there. So in pre-Christian Roman cemeteries, the number also is about 5 to 15%. So similar numbers, no change over there. In the reference of 1991 by Grindel and Hansel, they suggest that Charon's obol is a late addition to the myth, but obol is there, as it is mentioned on 405 BC. And It is a custom of the ancient people, especially after classical period. The conclusion is Charon's coins was not always a guideline on what the deceased people needed to pass on the underworld, but it was more of a symbolic gesture, an ideal, but not something that occurred regularly in reality. So the people knew that when their relatives will die, it would be a myth, it would be a good thing to put a coin, but it was not always a compulsory process to follow. So this is the end of my presentation. I am including references, and I will be happy to provide a copy of the presentation. You can see my email here. So if anybody is interested about one presentation, a copy of a presentation in PDF, please contact me and I will email back to you. I would be happy to reply in any questions if you have, and or any discussion if you wish. I don't know, Logan, if they sent any
so
questions
far,
by chat.
No questions, but if you guys do have any, please put them in the Q&A or in the chat so that I can read them to George. We'll give it about a minute, see if there's any that come in. That's okay. Again, that would need to be in the chat or the Q&A because we cannot hear you.
I hope that you enjoyed this presentation.
It was a great presentation.
A little bit history, a little bit coins.
Yeah,
a little
I
bit,
love
archaeology.
Yeah.
To get a full understanding how people were thinking about dead people on that time. And how these small, simple coins are a part of the history, and they tell a story not only about the coinage of each period and what people used to buy, that they used the coins to buy things or whatever, but these small coins is a whole history. They include a whole history, and they are speaking this history. And that's why also personally I enjoy collecting coins, because I don't care about the actual the value of the coin, but what I care is the history behind it, exploring a culture, way of life, everyday life of ancient people, and of course more technical issues like metallurgy and so on. I will have another presentation, I think in 2 months approximately. I'm going to talk a little bit more technical over there about the more engineering issues, about the quality control techniques and identification of fake coins in ancient Athens and so on. More technical, more metallurgy, but I would be happy to share it with you.
So we do have a question come in.
Yes, please.
Was the placement of the coins on the eyes a late development? Any arc evidence for it?
As we said, initially it was on the hand, later on it was on the mouth, and there are archaeological findings that it was on the eye. So it is probably the latest period, and it is not the most common.
All right, I think that's all of the questions. So thank you all for joining us today, and thank you, George, for a wonderful presentation. We look forward to seeing you all on future ANA presentations, and I hope you have a great weekend. And
I appreciate the invitation, and it was a pleasure.
Of course, I look forward to your presentation in a couple of months. We'll talk to you soon.
Have a great day or evening.